Hello friends and welcome to the classroom teaching. I am Shekhar. Friends, today we are going to discuss about a very simple question: how Kepler's third law helped Newton in finding his equation of universal law of gravitation. That means inverse square dependence on distance. That means we have to prove F is inversely proportional to d square. That is the inverse square dependence on distance. D is distance in that case, distance between two objects. So how Newton assumed the inverse square dependence on distance, that we are going to see today. That means definitely the Kepler's third law helped in that assumption, and today we will discuss about that. So to know that, to understand that, we must know what is circular motion, what is centripetal force. So let us recall our previous knowledge. Friends, here I have a small ball. So this is nothing but rotational motion, that we know. That means circular motion. What is circular motion? If the object is moving in a circular path, it is called as circular motion. And if the speed of the object, it remains constant, then it is called as uniform circular motion. So this ball is now in uniform circular motion. It is said to be in uniform circular motion if the speed of the ball, it is throughout constant. And if I want to keep that speed constant, then I have to constantly apply the force on it. If I doesn't apply force, then definitely the speed of the ball, it changes or it may stop. So to keep the uniform circular motion or to move the object in a uniform circular motion, one has to apply constant force. And that force, we know that force is nothing but centripetal force. We learned it about. So what is uniform circular motion then? Suppose the object is moving in a circular path. So we are saying the speed of the object, it remains constant, but we are saying about speed, not about velocity. We must know the difference between them. Speed and velocity. Speed is a scalar quantity and velocity is a vector quantity. That means if the ball is moving in a circular path with uniform circular velocity, uniform circular motion, then its speed must be constant, but the velocity definitely changes because it is a vector quantity and it depends on the direction. Friends, it is very easy to understand. Let us take the example of uniform circular motion. If the object is moving in uniform circular motion, let us draw a circle here. It is an easy method to draw a circle. So let us draw a circle here. So the object, suppose the object is moving in this circle. Suppose this is an object. It is moving in this circle, circular path. The velocity of the object is this at that time, at this time. But whenever it moves up to here, then its velocity is changing. Here, the velocity of the object is definitely here. It is the direction of the velocity. Actually, the speed is remaining constant, but the direction of the velocity, it changes. Direction of the motion, it changes continuously at every point. Whenever the object is moving in a circular path, its velocity changes due to the change in direction. So, if the velocity is changing, this motion is called as accelerated motion. Accelerated motion means the velocity of the object, it is constantly changing. So this motion is accelerated motion. And the force, it is towards the center. That means it is centripetal force. Suppose F, it is the force acting on it. How the direction it changes, for that you can see a very good example for that. Suppose a boy is running. Suppose you are running on a circular track. So, while running, the direction of your body, the direction of your face, that means the direction of motion, it is constantly changing. You can easily observe that. So, the velocity changes, and as the velocity changes, the motion is called as accelerated motion. That means a constant acceleration should be there. And that acceleration, we call it as A. This acceleration, it is a vector quantity, F is also a vector quantity. The direction of force, it is towards the center, and therefore we call it as centripetal force. The direction of acceleration, it should be towards the center. The direction of force and the direction of acceleration, both are same. They both are in the same direction towards the center, and therefore this acceleration is also called as centripetal acceleration. Friends, this centripetal acceleration, it is given by a formula. It is nothing but A is equal to V square upon R, where V, it is the velocity. Actually, it is angular velocity, but we are not going into details of that. So, the formula, just remember this formula. Acceleration, it is nothing but V square upon R, where R is the distance between this object and the center. That is nothing but R is the radius here. So it is acceleration is equal to V square upon R. Friends, what is the amount of centripetal force here? Force F is equal to, we know F is equal to mass into acceleration. So F must be equal to M into V square upon R. It is nothing but the centripetal force. Newton assumed the same thing. Newton convert for or assume for the gravitation also. That means rotational motion. Newton assumed that the planet, they are revolving around the sun in a circular path. As the object is moving here in a circular path, according to Newton, the planet is also revolving around the sun in a circular path. So, the similar force, here we say it is the centripetal force. But if we compare, if we say that this is a planet, and suppose the sun is present here in the center, so there must be the attraction force here. This attraction force, we call it as centripetal force, and therefore it must have the similar formula, F is equal to mv square upon R, where m is the mass of the planet, v is, definitely it is the angular velocity, and R, here in this case, R is radius. Radius means the distance between the planet and the sun. Here we consider R as a distance. In last period we say it is D. So whether it is D or R, it doesn't matter. It is just a later we consider here R may be the distance between this planet and the sun. So this is the formula for the force, that is nothing but the gravitational force acting on this planet due to the sun. This is the force of attraction. It is also centripetal force, that means toward the sun. So, F is equal to mv square upon R that we get here. F is equal to mv square upon R. But what is V? V, it is velocity. Let us forget about the distance, because it is angular velocity. Let us forget about the distance. So, it is nothing but speed. So, we know speed is equal to speed is equal to distance divided by time. Speed is nothing but distance divided by time. Suppose the object, it starts from this point. Suppose this is point A, and it completes one revolution and come back again to the point A. It covers this much distance here and come back again to the point A. And for that, it requires a time period which is called as T. This we learn in 8th standard. What is that T? T, it is nothing but the period of revolution, because we are considering here sun and this is planet. The time required to complete one revolution, one rotation around the sun, it is called as period of revolution, and it is given by capital T. So let us tell me how much distance it covers. It is very simple mathematically. We can say how much distance is covered. Starts from point A, it completes the circle and again come to point A in time period T. So how much distance is covered in that time? It must be the circumference of the circle, and it is given by 2 pi r. So V is equal to, that means speed is equal to, or V is equal to 2 pi r upon capital T. So let us replace this value 2 pi r upon T in the equation. This equation F is equal to mv square upon r, replace V is equal to 2 pi r upon T. It is now just go on solving it. So F is equal to, we get m into V square. What is V? V, it is nothing but 2 pi r upon capital T, that is nothing but period of revolution, divided by r. Here square, 2 pi r upon T whole square, because V square is there. Okay, let us calculate. M into 4 into pi square into r square upon T square divided by r here. So it is nothing but F. So it get cancelled out here. And we get F is equal to 4 into M into pi square into r, 4m pi square into r upon T square. I will draw here. So in this equation, F is equal to 4m pi square into r upon T square. Let us multiply and divide by r square here. Multiply and divide by r square. So let us see what is the equation. F is equal to 4m pi square into r cube upon T square into r square, or we can write r square into T square, r square into T square. If we see these two things, r cube upon T square, what is r cube upon T square? R cube upon T square, it must be constant. Why it is taken to be constant? It is from Kepler's third law. What is Kepler's third law? Kepler's third law, it is nothing but the period of square of the period of revolution of a planet is directly proportional to the cube of the mean distance between the planet and the sun. So it is nothing but t square is directly proportional to r cube according to Kepler's third law. If we replace this sign by equal to sign, then t square is equal to constant k into r cube. Take this r cube to this side. So t square upon r cube, it is equal to t square upon r cube is equal to constant. So what is r cube upon t square then? R cube upon t square is equal to 1 upon k. R cube upon t square is equal to 1 upon k. So from this derivation, from this Kepler's third law, we get R cube upon t square is equal to 1 upon k. So replace R cube upon t square by 1 upon k. So here, what is F then? F is equal to 4m pi square upon r square into 1 upon k. It is according to Kepler's third law of motion. Okay, so in this equation, we get F is equal to 4, it is a constant, m is also constant, it is the mass of a planet, pi is also constant, k is also definitely constant. So this force is nothing but constant into 1 upon r square. Only, that means the force, it depends on reciprocal or inverse square of the distance. That means from this, F is inversely proportional to 1 upon r square. So this is nothing but Newton's assumption, which is he assumed in his law of universal law of gravitation. What is the statement of universal law of gravitation there? The object, every object attract every other object with a force, definite force, which is directly proportional to the product of their masses and which is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. This square of the distance, inverse proportionality of square on distance, the dependence of the universal law of gravitation on square of the distance between the object, it is taken by Kepler's third law. So in this way, Kepler's third law helped Newton in finding his universal law of gravitation. Friends, it is very easy to solve this. Just a recap. How to solve this equation? First of all, we have to take one equation, F is equal to mv square upon r. It is nothing but centripetal force. It is in case of any uniform circular motion, the force which is directed towards center, it is centripetal force, and it is given by mv square upon r. Newton considered the same thing for planetary motion. Actually, the motion of a planet, according to Kepler, it is elliptical, but Newton assumed the same thing. According to Newton, he took the motion of the planet is the circular orbit, and the centripetal force F must be equal to mv square upon r, where m is the mass of planet, v is the velocity, and r is the distance between them. Okay, so in this equation, we have to replace v by distance
divided by time, and it is nothing but 2 pi r upon capital T. So replace this value here, instead of this we replace 2 pi r upon T. So it is m 2 pi r upon T whole square upon small r. So it is nothing but 4 m into pi square into r upon T square. This r get cancelled here. So this is equation. Here we have to multiply by r square upon r square in this equation. Then we get the final equation that F is equal to constant into 1 upon r square. So F is directly inversely proportional to r square. And this law, this universal law, it is true throughout the universe. That means we can see many of the examples of this universal law of gravitation. A very well-known example that we experience, that we can see, that is nothing but the high tides and low tides. On Earth, there are at many places at regular time interval, that means every day twice, there are high tides and low tides. And these high tides and low tides, it is also the effect of gravitation of moon. Moon attracts the water which is exactly below it, exactly behind the water which is present exactly below the moon. Moon attracts that water. Actually, the surface of moon, they are hard and solid, but the water which is present on the surface of Earth, it is in liquid state, and therefore it can flow. It gets attracted towards moon, and the water at that place, it increases, and therefore we can experience high tide there. And the reasons, the portions which are the two places on the Earth which are at 90 degree from that, at that places there must be low tides, because the water from that place, it gets attracted towards the moon. So these experiences, these are the natural phenomena that we can see. These are due to the universal law of gravitation, and Kepler helped Newton in finding this universal law of gravitation. Okay friends, so we will stop here today. In next lecture, we will see Earth's gravity, that means gravitation of Earth, and gravitational acceleration, that is small g, how it varies. So we will stop.